Hello everyone, welcome back to Online Biz TV. I am Ruth.
And I am Eric.
And today we are talking about how to handle a crisis in your business. The reason we have decided to make this conversational video now is because we've recently had a few crises in our business.
It's fresh. It's very fresh.
I actually think even calling it crises is maybe a bit much because it's really just problems that we have to solve. And as your business grows and advances, you have bigger and bigger problems to solve, to the point where if you look backwards a year later at something that felt like a crisis at the time, you're like, it was just something.
Yeah, it's a lot about perception, how you look at issues that comes up. But I do think that at a certain point, as your business grows, there's always going to be some sort of crisis going on. And you become like a firefighter. You just run from one department to another, trying to put up all the fires. But every once in a while, there just comes this issue that if it's not going to be taken care of in the short amount of, you know, in the nearest future, you're going to find yourself in a big problem business-wise. And this is what you can define, I think, as a crisis. And the beauty, or I wouldn't call it beauty, but the thing is it can really comes from, sometimes it comes from really unexpected areas of the business.
Yeah. And
yeah, that's the issues about crisis. I mean, some of the issues that comes up, sometimes there are things you're aware of that you're not taking good care of, but you kind of let it slide until sometimes something comes up and then it's catastrophical. And sometimes there are areas where you think you got them under control and still they burst like a volcano.
Yeah.
A sleeping volcano. I don't know if that's the right... how do you say when volcano...
Dormant.
Dormant.
Yeah. Dormant volcano, I think.
Erupts.
But yeah, I think you made a great point about how when something... You recognize something as a crisis when it's something that you have to handle it now or it will create a big issue for your business. Because like you said, you basically put out fires all day long when you own a business. And it's something that if you're thinking of starting a business, you need to know that and you need to be prepared because it is the reality of life. You will always get all the shit to on your plate as the business owner. This is where everything comes down to. That's on the one hand. But then something is a crisis when it is like keeping you awake at night, making you bothersome because you keep thinking about it. And you know that if you don't solve it, you will be in a really big issue. And I think one of the first things to kind of think about as far as crisis is how you talk to yourself about it. Because you said something about how it's catastrophical. And that's a lot of the times something happens that we perceive as a crisis and we kind of, this is the language we use to talk about it. We call it something catastrophical. This is the end. This is terrible. When in reality, a lot of the times a crisis is, again, like you said, something that kind of bubbles up some issues that were beneath the surface that you either ignored or were not aware of up until now. And then you can see this crisis instead of something catastrophical as an opportunity to fix deep issues that you didn't know about.
Yeah, and I think the thing is with crises, I don't know if that's the way to say it in plural, but they tend to attack the weakest parts of your business. And it's just whenever you grow, like as you grow, it's just going to happen in a higher frequency because usually the bigger you are, the more customer you have, the more users you have, the more people are after you. Not, you know, in a bad way, it's just the way things work. If you have more exposure for something, there's a good chance you're going to be also more open or more sensitive for certain issues that's going to come up. For example, if it's security, you at the beginning you might kind of let it go, but eventually as you grow, there's way more chances of hackers trying to hack your business. So that's just one thing, and it keeps coming usually at the weakest point of the business. And I think one other thing that helps you kind of define these crises, many times it's not even logical. It's emotional. It's the emotions that comes up when you just think about the things you have to handle. It's affecting your judgment, maybe it's affecting your clarity, and it's for me at least, I start to feel a little, I don't know if paranoid, but I'm getting back to feelings that I didn't have for years. And you start feeling about the worst things happen, and you think about everything crashes down, and you're going back to the old days when you didn't, still looking for what's the thing to do, and you kind of go through this path, and you kind of get this dirty pleasure out of these thoughts,
yeah,
instead of, you know, because sometimes it feels this way. But yeah, eventually, as you mentioned, every crisis is just another issue, maybe a big one that needs to be handled, and from there you can handle it just like anything else.
Yeah, I think it's kind of like when you were deep inside these emotions that you were talking about, it's kind of like picking a wound. Like, I think you do it a lot. You have a wound and you just can't stop picking, even though it's painful. And this is the same thing. You have painful emotions. You are driven by fear and you just can't stop thinking about it. It's a loop in your head. So I think really the first step into handling any crisis is to kind of take a step back of these emotions, whatever it is, fear, anger, your ego being hurt. A lot of the times it's an ego thing, and we need to be able to recognize it in ourselves and kind of take a step back and see how can we logically solve this without being driven from emotions, which is not always easy. I mean, I think you kind of need to let yourself feel these emotions and then you can take a step back.
Yeah.
It's not always easy, but it's the only way to kind of solve the issue instead of just being focused on these negative emotions all the time and feeling kind of like a victim because you're not, just because you have a crisis.
Yeah, and I think, so that's a great point. Eventually, it all comes back to logic when it comes to solutions. So crises can be very emotional, but the solutions can't. Solutions can't be emotional. Emotional solutions tends to be destructive, and you don't want to go this route. And the reason I'm saying that is because in many times, these crises have another party. So it's you and the other party. And it can be another software, someone you're working with, a partner, a supplier, anything that is on the other side may cause the issue. And many times, you know, it's in-person relations that are causing these issues. Usually it's not like a black and white stuff, and you know, people sometimes stop getting along and things are just not going as well as planned. One of the things that will help you to find the right solutions logically is to really be empathetic, and it's very hard to do, especially when you're like you feel the wrath everywhere in your body, like every cell in your body is trying to scream at someone. But instead of that, you really need to understand his side, try to understand where he's coming from. And again, this is, I'm telling you, this is a very hard thing to do, because your mind is going to keep getting you back to what you're thinking and what kind of an asshole the other side is, and how wrong they are about their decision making, and if they need to change, and they it keeps getting you there. But if you can really eliminate your side and try to look at it as objectively as possible, you know what, forget objectively, look at it subjectively, but from the other side, then things look a little bit different. And if you really do that, you will understand the other side. And once you understand the other side, you also understand what they want. And once you understand what they want or what they need, then you can figure out a solution that is good in a way for all parties. Now, in many cases, it's going to mean you have to settle, but that's fine, because it's better than nothing. It's better than like this X, like 1-0, zero sum game that someone loses and someone wins, or you just blow everything up.
I think just listening to you talk, we can even change the word crisis to conflict. I mean, it's really, it's relevant for crises, but it's also relevant for any kind of conflict handling. Your intuition might be, not intuition, but your instinct might be, okay, this person hurt me, it's their fault. Even if you manage to see what they want, you might now say, okay, now I'm going to take away what they want because they deserve a punishment.
Yeah.
And I am right here. And the whole idea is not to stay in the mindset that you are right and they're wrong, but actually look, when you look at it, like you said, on both sides, you can figure out what is a win-win solution. Instead of butting heads in a constant war where you're trying to one-up each other, you can just say, okay, I want us both to be successful. I don't want to hurt the other side. And from understanding their point of view, I can now offer a few solutions that I think would work for both sides. Communicate it, create clarity with how everything that is happening affects you on the one hand and how it affects the other side on the one hand and how you can solve it together in a win-win situation. And then it's kind of, you kind of leave it to the other side to decide which of the options you gave him he wants.
Yeah.
What he wants to take.
Now, we spoke mostly about, relationships issues. Obviously, there are different crises that are related to performance, code, crashes, some things that kind of crash during your day-to-day.
We can give an example.
Yeah, for example, you have a service with thousands of active users and then it crashes.
Repeatedly.
And then...
True story, by the way.
Yeah, true story. one of our biggest app used to crash a lot. And every time, it's just, you need to stop everything, no matter the time, no matter where you are, and fix it. Now, it can also be, let's say, you have a critical bug within your app or something like that. So all of these crises are also they're a different type of crises, but these are easier because they're very logical. You know, like, the app is down, let's bring in everyone, let's have an emergency meeting, understand where this issue comes from, fix it. After, like, let's just, you know, put up a patch so it's not going to leak. And then once it's fixed, once everything is back to normal, now it's time to call the plumber and try to understand how to fix the system itself. Okay, so that's fine. First, you need to patch it. Then you need to find, like, a better solution, like a holistic solution for the entire problem. Obviously, this is usually not the case with in-person relation issues. So it's a little bit different, but it's
the thing is, it kind of is the same. The only difference with a relationship and in-person problem like that is our emotions getting in the way.
Yeah.
And then we can't just figure out, okay, we have problem X, let's use tactic Y to solve it for the short term and tactic Z to solve it for the long term.
Yeah.
This is exactly what we should do in any kind of crisis, but we can't do it if our emotions are too involved. If I was angry at our app when it was crashing down, then I would be focused on being angry at the app for crashing down instead of finding a solution. So I think that's the meat of it, is to handle your emotions. Really.
Yeah, but I do think that specifically, maybe in such cases when something crashes, it's a little bit easier for us because there is no one to be mad at for real, or there is no one to be disappointed from for real. You care more about, okay, there is something that if it's not going to be fixed now, we're fucked.
Yeah.
So we need to fix this, and then, like, we'll figure out the other issue. When it's with other people, sometimes you can get so disappointed for someone that you just want to burn the bridges and you really don't care about what it's going to look like. How could they do this to me? Or how could they misunderstand so much, something I said so much? So it gets a little harder. Maybe actually the emotional stuff, the emotional maturity is the harder part. I never thought about it this way, actually.
It's really nice, the emotions. And it's, I think we talked about it in the conversation we had with Poptin, where they asked us how we handle disagreements between us. And one of the first things I said when they asked that was that neither of us handles that out of our egos, which allows it to never become a conflict. It's a disagreement, we talk about it and we agree on something. And the only reason we can do that is because I'm okay with not being right, because I'm not worried about hurting my ego in front of you, and vice versa. And when someone hurts you, when you feel like someone does something that you don't deserve, that is like backstabbing or something like that, your ego gets activated immediately. I can't do the sound, but I can do the hand motion.
Yeah.
So it immediately gets activated, and then it's really difficult to step out of it and actually look at things and say, okay, let's manage it like any other crisis. This is not this big of a deal, but our emotions tell us that it is.
Yeah, and it's painful.
Yeah.
By the way, guys, before we move on to like a few final thoughts about this topic, if you've ever had to deal with any crisis in your business, we would be happy if you can mention it in the comment section below so that other people can also see what you dealt with. If you had a unique or creative solution, also let us know. And if you think we forgot something until now, just, you know, put it in the comment section below. If you like it, give us this like, thumbs up. You know, YouTube really help us if you guys engage with the video, and we're doing it for free because we love sharing. So you can help us, yes, with a little engagement. I think we pretty much discussed almost all of the points that we wrote down to ourselves, except for the last one. The one thing that is important when it comes to crisis management is to learn, and this is true for everything in business. There are no failures as long as you keep learning and you keep improving. There is no wrong way. I mean, there is no way to avoid crises completely. I think everybody suffers crises in their business, but you really need to, after it's done, you need to sit down, understand what went wrong and why, and make sure that from now on, this crisis is not going to come back again. No matter how big the change is need to be done, it needs to be acted upon right away. And it cannot, if a crisis, I mean, fool me once, shame on
you.
On you, fool me once, shame on me. That's exactly that. So it's okay if you get, I mean, you can't anticipate what you can't anticipate, but once something happened, you can already anticipate it for the next time. So make sure to avoid it in advance.
And be proactive, basically. Yeah. I think, again, let's just give a quick example of something that's not emotionally charged. The app that we had, it used to crash all the time. It crashed because the user base was growing very fast and our servers were not ready to handle it. So we patched each time the app crashed. We did something to make sure it went back up until... By the way, I was in Universal Studios Orlando last time it happened, and instead of being on a roller coaster, I sat in Starbucks for like an hour on the phone with our DevOps guys and our developers trying to figure out what the issue was. Just a little anecdote.
And I thought for me it was bad. I was in Washington, D.C.
But Washington is boring anyway.
So boring. Don't go there. Yeah. If you hate Washington, D.C., give us a thumbs up.
We're going to get in trouble with all of the Americans.
No. We love America. We don't like Washington, D.C. That's not it. If you like Manhattan, give us a thumbs up.
So we figured out how to take the app back up online and give service to our customers. But we understood after like three times of this happening that we were missing something. The core issue, we couldn't solve it because we couldn't find it. So first thing we had to do was change our DevOps team. We figured out that the guy we had doing DevOps, he was great until this point, but it became over his experience and capabilities. So we switched to another team. And then with them, we kind of researched everything and we ended up doing a full process of switching to new servers on Amazon. We were not on Amazon before that. So switching to new servers and, taking the app down for like a few hours by our decision, just so we can switch to the new servers and stop these crashes.
Yeah.
It was the only solution and it wasn't comfortable and it took away from development time. It took away from our time. It was not fun, but we had to do it. And ever since then, the app has not crashed yet.
Yeah. And the thing is, we try to build it in a way that is scalable, that we have a few backups just in case that something happens. That everything can compensate for any issues within it. We also got a consultation from database experts to make sure that we don't have any unnecessary calls in our we don't have any unnecessary calls from our database that are going to take too long, that they're going to crash the app, because we used to have that as well. So again, when it happens, it felt really bad. We understood we must stop literally everything we're doing to take care of it. We understood that even if we're going to have to manually take the app down, and even if it's going to stop development and progress of the app on other areas, everything stopped. It's fixed in a very, very
core level,
very thorough way. And hopefully it's not going to come back again. Now, specifically when it comes to crises with people, I think maybe it's not the best place to give examples, you know, because again, trying to be empathetic, there is another side always. And it's not okay to just give you guys one side of the coin. But I'll say this, we try to always come up with a solution that is a win-win situation for both sides, even if we end up a little unhappy from it. Like, if it's not 100%, that's fine. Yeah, I think this is it. Anything else we need to talk about?
No, I think this is definitely it. I think when we talk about managing crises in business, a lot of these things are relevant to managing any kind of crises and conflicts in real life as well. I think when you start, we've gotten to talk about it recently a lot. When you start dealing with like things that feel so big in your business, suddenly some things that you used to look at as crises in real life become kind of like just another problem to solve.
It's another
you get really good at problem solving, basically.
Yeah.
But every time the stakes go up and you have to get better, and every time it feels difficult again and again. So I think this is maybe the main lesson. It's always going to be difficult. It's never going to become easy, but you got this. Like, you can do this. That's the thing we tell ourselves.
You can definitely do this. You need to look at the world as your playground. You need to be creative. There is no black and white solution to everything. There is no like rule book to how you should manage life. And the thing is, every business is also very different. So you can really make it elastic and plastic and play with it. And it's like water. If you're trying to be creative, you're going to be able to come up with a lot of unique solutions, and you're going to be able to, you know, tap yourself at the back at the end of the day and be very happy with what you come up with. And most importantly, be able to move forward and keep fulfilling yourself and keep doing what you love. And over time, I think you also learn to make the better out of it. You know, I just thought of another example of crisis back in the day. Me and my previous partner, we used to have this online store, still losing a lot of money. Sorry, we were about to wrap this up.
No, go ahead.
Just remembered about it. And we were really, really good back in the day at reframing everything in a positive way. And we were like already so much behind all of our bills. We were so much deeply in debt. That was really, really bad time of my life. And we were happy because we had a phone call and we had a customer placing an order for like $4,000. And we were so happy. We were psyched about it. And then 1 month later, we got a chargeback for this order and the money was lost. And we were already, I think that was one low point where we understood that, holy shit, things are gonna get bad right now, because we have no money, we are already in extra debt, and now we got this extra thing that's going to break us. And we reframed it in a way that's like, okay, cool, now we know that we need to handle this chargeback stuff. It's not something we can ignore. Now, obviously, this shouldn't happen, but if it's already happened, you should just learn from it for the next times. It's the same idea. Reframe it, try to be happy about it, and, you know, move on with your life.
Yeah,
one last point I wanted to add.
Amazing example, because this one also has more emotional charge, because it was kind of like
being kicked.
It could crush your business.
Yeah,
like at this point,
it's more than your business at that point. It's everything you got, because if it's not going to work, where we had back in the day, if it wasn't going to work, we were in a very bad place.
Yeah,
yeah,
I remember. Okay, so I think we talked a lot about crises. I think there's so much to say about this. It's kind of an integral part of life and of business. Nothing ever goes smoothly. Failures are a part of business, crises, conflicts. And for me personally, I've always been a person who kind of avoids conflicts. So this kind of is teaching me and forcing me to not be a person who avoids conflicts. So Basically, business is kind of like a self-improvement on the fast track when you get into that. Yeah. But I think we can kind of wrap this topic up. Let us know if you find this interesting. It's a little less SaaS and business oriented than our other conversationals. Thank you, guy, with a hunk. Okay.
It's Israel.
It's a full conversation between them. Okay, so basically, if you enjoy these kind of videos and these kind of topics, let us know in the comments. If not, if you prefer the more like SaaS oriented and technical business stuff, also let us know in the comments.
Yeah.
And we will see you in the next video.
Bye.